a flower for you.
Thank you. It's my great honor to be here today. I was last in ERISA maybe 10 or 12 years ago, and the changes, and quite impressive, all the accomplishments in the last decade. So I wanted to talk a little bit about the global energy challenge, and also in the context of what I hope will be a burgeoning relationship, between the University of Chicago and the state of ERISA. So the global energy challenge, is a lot of it is embedded in this picture, which is a picture from Delhi. In this picture, I think you can see there's, I think of the global energy challenge as having kind of a stool that has three legs. And all three of those legs are visible in this picture. The first leg of the stool is, how do we get access to inexpensive and reliable energy, and the inexpensive and reliable energy that's so critical for economic growth? And you can see that in the background of the picture there, behind the boys. You can see the cars driving and the guys on the motorbikes, and the advancement of living standards that has really all been driven would not have been possible without access to energy. The second leg of the stool, which is interrelated, is that the same energy sources that are powering people moving around and driving in that picture are also causing the air pollution that is visible in that picture and that the young men are very aware of. And that air pollution comes bundled with health problems and ultimately leads to sicker and shorter lives, and that's something I'm going to talk a little bit about. And the third leg of the stool is not visible there, but it's also evident that the same fuels that are powering the cars and causing the air pollution are also involve the release of CO2, and that CO2 is changing the climate. I really think of that as the global energy challenge. How do we find access to reliable and inexpensive sources of energy without unleashing unwanted health problems from air pollution and other sources of pollution, and without leading to disruptive climate change? And so I'll talk more about that as we go along. So just to start, I think with that background, I like to think of this as having seven facts that kind of frame my thinking about the global energy challenge. And the first, I spend a lot of my time analyzing data, and one of the most frustrating things about analyzing data is that data is so often disappointing, and it's so often disappointing in that you have some idea or some hypothesis, and the data lets you down in some way that you didn't expect. This is an example where that was not true, and on the horizontal axis, there's energy consumption. And on the y-axis, there's GDP, or income per capita. And the key point to take away from that is that when you use data from around the world, we just don't have a single instance of countries attaining high living standards without using lots and lots of energy. So there's just no getting around that access to energy, inexpensive energy, is critical for growth. So that's fact one. The second fact is that which is also embedded here, is that energy access is a major problem in many parts of the world. And I'm always struck, every time I see this chart, I'm a little bit taken aback by the magnitude of some of the disparities around the planet. But in the United States, where I'm from, per capita electricity consumption is about 13,000 kilowatt hours per person per year. In Germany and parts of Europe, it's maybe in the five to six to 7,000 kilowatt hours per person per year. And I guess the global average is about 3,100. But what I want you to take away is that there are large parts of the world where the levels of consumption are much lower than they are in, say, Europe and the United States. China, it's about 3,700 kilowatt hours per person. And then, of course, in India, it's about 1,300 kilowatt hours per person. The state of Bihar has a number that is almost hard to believe is true, but it's about 100 or 150 kilowatt hours per person. And Odisha is actually quite high by the standards of India. It's maybe at about, I guess now at about 1,200 kilowatt hours per person. But the major point I want to make is that I don't think I need to, you know, normally when I'm speaking in the United States, this requires some emphasis, but I don't think I have to explain to anyone here that this is not an acceptable state of affairs, the low rate of energy consumption, and that India and the state of Odisha has great plans to increase that, and that's a fact. Okay. The third fact kind of follows from these, and that's demand for energy is going to grow rapidly around the world, but it's almost all going to occur in today's developing countries. And so here's just a picture. The blue line is total energy demand in OECD countries, and you can see that it's basically been flat since 2005 and is projected to be flat all the way out to 2040. But the green line is projections from the OECD of, or is projections of non-OECD countries, including India and China and other countries, and you can see there's just projected to be tremendous growth. And so, if one thinks about the global energy challenge, what this is saying that all of the growth is going to projected to occur in today's developing countries. Okay, now. That's all fine and well, but I want to return to the second and third legs of the stool of the global energy challenge that I talked about a moment ago, and talk about why is that large growth in energy demand anything, why should it be anything but celebrated? And this fact four is that fossil fuels are expected to meet much of this growth, and so when one just goes to the projections, here's world primary energy demand. The bottom three bars are coal, oil, and natural gas, the fossil fuels. And you can see going out to 2040, even though there have been great advances in renewables and other sources of energy, the fossil fuels are still expected to play a significant role. And in fact, by 2040, I think fossil fuels are projected to account for 85% of energy consumption. So the fossil fuels are not going to go away. And you can also do the same exercise for India. And you can see this is 2014 and then projections for 2040 that almost all the growth is going to be coming from fossil fuels. It's not that some of the other areas aren't going to get a little bit larger, but they're off very, very small bases. And you know, nuclear is a very complicated technology. Toshiba appears to be going bankrupt, you know, in many respects, the fossil fuels are quite reliable. And so, why is it that the world places such great weight on fossil fuels? And admittedly, I apologize; these numbers are from the United States; they're not from India. But the answer is true almost everywhere in the world, and the answer is that the fossil fuels are incredibly inexpensive when judged by the cost of producing a unit of energy. And so here I've just plotted the cost of producing a kilowatt hour of electricity from a variety of different sources. And you can see in the United States, it's about 3 cents a kilowatt hour when it comes from an existing coal plant. If you used a new natural gas plant, which is taking advantage of the fracking revolution in the United States, it's maybe 5 or 6 cents. And then as you move to the other technologies, it gets more expensive. And so the key point I want to just make is what's driving the heavy reliance on fossil fuels is not a mystery. It's very inexpensive to produce energy from them, and that's evident here. And it's not just that the fossil fuels are inexpensive, it's that they're incredibly abundant. And so if you just never mind the red line, there's more coal than I think probably the world knows what to do with. And I know Odisha is well endowed with coal, like many other places. But what I find especially striking about the green and the blue lines there, which are, I have to say it slowly, is the fossil, they are the reserves to production ratios. So think of it as how much we know is there, and we know we can get it at today's prices, divided by how much the world is using in a year. And so if you go to the beginning of that chart and you look at oil, it looks like in 1980, there were about 35 years left of petroleum. And what's striking is you move across that, that if that were had really been true, we would have been at zero by 2015. And it just underscores the ingenuity and the innovation of the fossil fuel companies that continually been able to find more and more coal, more and more of all the fossil fuels, oil and natural gas. And I think the idea that the day will come when we run out of fossil fuels is not something that I would place a very large bet on. And indeed, the data suggests we're going to have fossil fuels. Yes, there's a finite amount in the planet, but we're getting better and better at finding them. Okay, so there's going to be a big increase in energy demand. A lot of it's going to happen in developing countries. It's critical for economic growth. It appears that a lot of it is likely to be driven by fossil fuels. So what's the problem with that? And so fact five, I'm going to go a little bit in into detail here on a recent paper of mine, which tries to measure, well, what are the consequences of air pollution associated with the consumption of fossil fuels in terms of life expectancy? And this is the challenge for researchers is to find a setting where everything else is held constant. And so what do I mean by that? What we would like to do from a pure research perspective, maybe not for societal good, but from a pure research perspective, is one would like to run an experiment, a real experiment, where you have a treatment group who gets assigned to air pollution for their whole life, and a control group who is assigned to having clean air for their whole life, and then you want to find out what happens to their, how sick is the treatment group relative to the control group. So that's never, we're never going to run that experiment, thankfully, but instead, what this paper is about is we found a setting that approximates that experiment. And in this setting, we're exploiting, China had back in the planning period, started something called the Huai River Winter Heating Policy, where between approximately November 15th and March 15th, they provided free coal and built boilers to provide free heating, except they didn't have enough money to do it for the whole country. So they kind of very arbitrarily drew a line across the middle of the country. Said if you live to the north of this line, you can have this free coal and this free winter heating every winter. And if you live to the south, it's not just that we won't provide it for free, it's forbidden. And that was started in the 50s. And an unintended consequence of that was that they didn't install any pollution abatement equipment on those boilers. And it led to massive, I'm going to show you, massive differences in air pollution concentrations north of the river versus south of the river. And so what I want to try to measure in this paper with my co-authors is what are the consequences of that for life expectancy. So here's an example of the boiler heating system in a northern city in China. And you can see these are not great big power generating stations. Rather, they're kind of small little boilers that are attached to apartment complexes with no real pollution abatement equipment on them. Here's the Huai River. And again, the idea is to compare people who are just to the north of the river versus people who are just to the south of the river. And you know, I should just mention the legacy of this policy continues today. There's the city of Chengdu, which is in the south, but it's in the northern part of the south, so it has pretty cold winters. I lectured at a university there one time in the winter, and in a room not that dissimilar to this, there was no heating, and all the students had on winter coats. And that's just the way the legacy of the policy lasts. So the first thing I'm going to show you is, well, what happened to air pollution? And this figure is a little complicated to describe, but the vertical line, so the difference between the red and the blue dots, marks the Huai River. And so the red dots are as you move 1 degree latitude to the north of the river, and the blue dots from the vertical line move 1 degree south of the river. And what the figure shows you is that there's this really discrete change in air pollution concentrations right at the river. Indeed, it's about 40 grams per cubic meter of PM10. It's about 50, and so it leads to pollution differences that are about 50% higher north of the river. Okay, and so now, hopefully, I've built great anticipation for what's coming, and I'm going to have an identical figure, except instead of pollution, I'm going to have life expectancy. And we will test whether or not there's a mirror image result, which is at the places at higher pollution, do we actually see lower life expectancy? And again, as I said, you know, as I like to tell my undergraduates when my kind of intro to data analysis class, analyzing data is a little bit like the worst boyfriend or girlfriend that you ever had in high school. And you know, what characterizes the worst boyfriend or girlfriend that you ever had in high school? It's that you knew that they were going to disappoint you, you just didn't know in what way yet. And so every day was like a new day where you could figure out how I can be disappointed in this new way. But here's an exception. And remarkably, this discrete difference in air pollution appears to show up. It was a discrete difference in life expectancy. And in particular, the people who were the intended beneficiaries of the policy, that is the people who lived to the north, appear to be living about 3.5 or maybe 4 years less. And that's due to elevated mortality rates that occur throughout the life cycle, not just the young and the old, and appear to be almost entirely concentrated in causes of death that are plausibly related to air pollution, so cardiorespiratory causes of death. So it's just worth noting that part of this global energy challenge is particulate matter, and you can see that it is a problem in many parts of the world. You can see the northern part of China, which we were just looking at. You can also see this industrial band in India has very high concentrations of particulate matter. And this is a source of shorter and sicker lives throughout the world. So that is this increasing, or this demand for more and more energy, which appears likely to be driven by the use of fossil fuels, an unintended consequence of those fossil fuels will be higher levels of air pollution without proper controls, and that brings along with it health problems. So the next fact is that these fossil fuels, in addition to producing the high levels of air pollution, are also causing climate change. And so I don't know about you, and so I apologize, and I guess I'm probably telling too much about my childhood here, but when we were in grade school, every year the teachers in the beginning of the year would announce, this is the year we're going to convert from Fahrenheit to Celsius. And it would be true for about 2 weeks, and then about 2 weeks after that they would just say, oh, forget it, let's stick with Fahrenheit. So I'm very bad at Celsius, and this is just a figure of how much warming is possible. And the gray bar, and the short answer is there's really a kind of unimaginable amount of warming that is possible with respect to climate change. And the gray bar is just how much warming has been baked into the planet since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. The next bar is how much warming we would get from using fossil fuel proven reserves. And the next two are, if we use a different category called resources, those are fossil fuel deposits that we know are there, but we would have to have higher market prices to justify getting them. And if you added it all up, it's about 16 degrees Fahrenheit. So really, which I guess is about 8 degrees Celsius. A really dramatic change. But maybe an easier way to see this, and again, I apologize for the Fahrenheit here, is I just plotted here the distribution of average temperatures in India. And the way you would read that is that the typical person in India faces about 60 days a year where the temperature is between 79 and 81 degrees Fahrenheit. And you can see there's a couple days that the typical person faces where it's greater than 97. And there's not very many cold days in India. So what would happen if we got to the end of the century with unrestrained climate change, that is that the world did not pursue vigorous climate policy? Well, this is what the distribution of days would look like. And you can see that there would be this big movement of days to the very hottest, temperature days. And that's troubling because I think it's not that it's a little bit difficult to understand, at least for me, what does 2 degrees C mean, but I can understand what additional hot days mean. And that's where a lot of the damages from extreme climates come from. That's where the crops have a very hard time. That's where human health is compromised in a variety of other measures of human well-being. And so now I'm going to talk a little bit, about how large or how in what the damages might be from this and from higher temperatures. And so this is drawing from some data. So I think these slides are slightly out of order. Yeah. Okay. So let's start with this. So this is drawing from some data from the United States. And it asks, what's the relationship between the annual mortality rate and hot days? And the exercise here is, what happens if you swap a day from the 70 to 74 range and move it to any of these others? What happens to the annual mortality rate? And the key thing to take away from that is it's completely flat. And that is, hot days don't lead to higher rates of mortality, and cold days don't really lead to higher rates of mortality, and that's because the United States has spent a lot on air conditioning and a variety of other adaptive techniques. Now, a different question is, well, what would happen in India? And so using data from 1957 to 2004 in India, you can conduct the same exercise. And here you can see that the results are really shocking. The way to read this is an extra day, if you took a day from the 70 to 74 range and put it up at greater than 95, each additional one of those days increases the annual mortality rate by about almost a percentage point. And at the very hottest levels, the effect of a hot day is maybe 20 times larger in India than it is in the United States. And it helps underscore that the damages from climate change are going to be spread out around the world in very unequal ways. It obviously reflects the higher underlying temperatures to begin with in India. It's also true when one talks about climate change if one were to look at the historical shares of what fraction of CO2 in the atmosphere comes from different countries, can see that the United States accounts for almost a fifth of all CO2 that has been put into the atmosphere. And then I've also put China and India out here, and we could add other places as well. If we zoom ahead to 2050, you can see that the arithmetic starts to change, the United States becomes a relatively smaller share. Now, obviously, the United States has a much smaller population. But you can see that the share of India really grows dramatically. The share of China really grows dramatically, and India's share also grows as well. And if you go to the end of the century, those patterns become even starker. And the key thing to take away from that, I think, in my view, is that, and this is really why the global energy challenge is such a challenge, is that the very parts of the world that need energy the most are exposed to the damages from climate change the most, B are the places that in one way or another are the world will be looking for smaller fossil fuel or smaller CO2 emissions. Now, that's an entirely separate question, is who should pay for that? And I am not taking a stand on that. I think there's a very strong case that the cost should be shared globally. But the key thing is that in the very places in the world that need lots of growth of energy consumption, there is also this tension with climate change. Okay. Then the last fact is that the Paris Agreement that is expected to help, but maybe only some. And so the red line reports what would happen to global mean temperatures without any change in, without any real baseline as usual scenario, without any real policy. And you can see that by the end of the century, temperatures are projected to increase by about 8 degrees Fahrenheit or 4.5 degrees Celsius. If the Paris Agreement, people comply with the Paris Agreement, and there's, I think, very open question about whether or not the United States is any longer poised to comply, as an example, you would end up with the blue line, and then the green line is what the scientists recommend for holding global mean temperatures to 2 degrees C warming. And you can see that that would be a very drastic change in greenhouse gas emissions. Okay, so my wife often says that that part of the talk, the seven facts, can be a little gloomy. And so now I'm going to try and talk about that I think, although the challenge is real, I think there's lots of opportunity for finding successes or ways to make progress. And the first one I'll just point to, and let's just return to this picture. I've now turned it, rotated it 90 degrees. And as I mentioned, markets are pushing people to use fossil fuels because they're so inexpensive. But the reason that they're so inexpensive is because we ignore the external costs that they impose. That is, we ignore the health costs associated with air pollution. We ignore the CO2 emissions and their consequences for climate change. And if one instead had prices that reflected the full costs, and so that, again, it's not, I just want to make clear, it's not that we don't pay those costs, it's just that we pay them currently in a very opaque way. We have shorter and sicker lives that are due to the fossil fuels, but when one goes to the gas pump, that is not reflected in the price people pay. But if you were to have very robust social cost of carbon, that is, had energy prices reflect what their private cost plus, in this case, just their carbon cost, you would end up with a very different picture. So nuclear power, which basically, you know, looks like it's on a lifeline around the globe, would suddenly be very competitive, maybe the least expensive energy source out there. Combined cycle natural gas plants would look very appealing. Coal would suddenly, right now, coal looks like a bargain around the world, but that's because we're ignoring these social costs. And if the cost of coal, if those social costs were reflected in the price people had to pay, very little coal would be purchased. And you can see that in by this estimate, the cost of coal would have increased from maybe 6 or 7 cents a kilowatt hour all the way to 23 cents a kilowatt hour. So just a complete game changer. And if markets reflect, if prices reflected that, markets would make, cause us to make different choices. All right. The second solution, I think, that has to be part of solving the global energy challenge is investing in innovation. And one thing to note, so here's some data from India. This is the solar generation prices versus Indian coal. And you can see in just the last 5 years, it's been an astonishing decline in the number of rupees per kilowatt hour. It's gone from maybe 8 or 9 all the way down to, and I guess last week there was a sale at about less than 3 rupees per kilowatt hour. And that has been is proving to be a game changer. We'll have to see if the people making those bids are able to deliver on everything that they're promising. But it is suddenly the case that the economics due to innovation in coal may be changing the playing field a little bit, and time will have to tell about that. It is still true that there's probably not enough investment in energy R&D, and here's just the share of energy R&D as a share of GDP for several countries around the world, and it is all much lower than it was in the 1970s. And arguably, the need for energy innovation is even greater now than it was then. Okay, and then the last tool that I think could be very effective and is part of the reason I'm so excited to be here today is that I think there are really tremendous opportunities to identify effective policy actions. And that those opportunities really haven't existed before, and it's due to increases in computing power and increases in access to data. And I think the development of a new model of collaboration between universities and governments. And I'll talk a little bit about some work that we're doing with EPIC India, which is housed at the University of Chicago's Delhi Center. And I'm gonna talk in particular about a project that we did that led to a very successful policy change in Gujarat. So when we began this project, and this is a picture outside Surat in the state of Gujarat, they had two ways, the government, the Gujarat Pollution Control Board had two ways that they were determining which plants were complying with their standards and which ones were exceeding them. One was they had government inspectors who would periodically go and take readings maybe once or twice a year from the plants. And the second is they had a requirement that all plants hire an auditor. So that is go to the private market and hire an auditor who would come, take a pollution reading, and then send it to the government. And in principle, the industry could be punished based on the readings that the auditor reported. Now, when we started to interact with the government, they said, well, you know, we're thinking of getting rid of the auditor program. It doesn't seem to be working. You know, look out the window and you see all of this pollution. And yet we get back reports from the auditors saying that everything is fine, all the plants are in compliance, so it doesn't really seem like this is working very well. And we said, well, you know, who is paying the auditors and who's choosing the auditors? And they said, oh, well, you know, the industries are paying the auditors and they're choosing the auditors. And we said, well, you know, maybe there's a conflict of interest there. And so what we developed was an idea to try to break that conflict of interest. And we did that in three different ways. One, we no longer let the industries choose their auditor. Two, we no longer let the industries directly pay the auditor. They paid to a central pool and then the pool paid the auditor. And three, we did some back checks on the auditors. And if we got a reading that was similar to them, then we gave them a cash bonus. And we designed that hand in hand with the regulators at, and the member secretary of the Gujarat Pollution Control Board. And we then divided, took 1,000 industries and put 500 into a control group and 500 into a treatment group. And in the control group, they continued to do things exactly as they had been doing them. And in the treatment group, they had this new system where with this aims of breaking the conflicts of interest. And so here's, there's basically three sets of results. I love this figure. So this is the vertical line there says that's the standard by which all these plants had to comply with for particulate matter pollution. And so everyone had to be below that standard. And this is the information in the control or status quo that the regulator was getting, that basically almost all the plants were beneath the standard. A couple were above. You have to wonder what kind of, how they were choosing their auditors. There must have been something wrong there. But this is the information that the regulator was concerned about. Now, what we were able to show by doing our back checks is that the truth was very different. And so the green bars are the different. Are the truth, and you can see that in practice 60% of the plants were exceeding the standard, but the regulator was not finding that out, or the Gujarat Pollution Control Board is not finding it out. So there's really three results of this paper. The first one is that it was indeed the case that reporting was corrupted in the status quo. The second finding comes from the treatment group. And here's what the auditors were reporting for the treatment group. And you can see that they were reporting a much more dispersed distribution of pollution readings, including a lot of readings that were above the standard. And for these plants, here's the truth, which is what we got from the back checks. And you can see that the distributions match each other quite well. Not perfectly, but very well. And so it appears that the intervention broke the conflict of interest and allowed the auditors to start telling the truth. And then the third and most important result is that the industry is recognizing that the regulator knew what the truth was now. We went back and measured their pollution emissions 6 months later to find out, did they change their behavior? And amazingly, they had reduced their pollution by 30% in the treatment group relative to the control group. So it turns out that this simple change in not allowing people to pick their auditor and not allowing them to pay their auditor, by changing economic incentives, created a setting where the plants began to comply much more with the regulations. And so here's a quote from Hardik Shaw, who was a kind of visionary member secretary of the Gujarat Pollution Control Board. We're also doing some other work in Bihar with the distribution companies there, and that work has been very effective at increasing the rates of payment that people are making to the distribution company and reducing the losses. Indeed, we've been able to increase the revenue that the distribution company receives by about 40%, and then they have been able to plow that back into increasing supply of electricity. And I know that distribution losses are a problem in many states, including this one. And in principle, this has identified a solution. And indeed, the state of Bihar is now going to roll it out through the whole state. These results, experimental results, are just from 8 districts. Okay, another thing that we have done at Epic India in trying to build these partnerships between government and universities is we did an innovation challenge, and we announced that we wanted people to come forward with their best ideas to improve energy access or reduce environmental problems in Delhi. This was done in collaboration with the government in Delhi. And we received about, and that we would then fund both an evaluation and the implementation of these ideas. We received, I think, almost 300 applications. Some of them were better than others. And ultimately, we ended up choosing 3 of them. And those 3 are being implemented, and we are evaluating them in the same way we did in Gujarat and that we're doing in Bihar to try and identify what works and what doesn't work as well. And there's a commitment from the Delhi government that whatever we find, if it's successful, they aim to turn it into policy. Okay. And the last project I'll just tell you about, it's ongoing, is in the state of Maharashtra, where we're taking advantage of that they have been collecting pollution concentrations out of stacks in their industries for the last several years. And I realize I'm running out of time, so let me just come to maybe the most important thing, which is we have coded all that data and we created this website. And on this website, you can click on different districts in Maharashtra, and then they'll show you where plants are. And then you can click on the plant, and you can see every plant has been awarded, and we developed the rating system in collaboration with the Maharashtra Pollution Control Board, but every plant has been awarded a number of stars from 1 to 5. 5 indicating the lowest levels of pollution, and 1 and 2 being out of compliance with the norms. And what we aim to do is to see, this is a very inexpensive form of environmental regulation. You just post it on the web. And see, and what we're going to test is whether or not as in Gujarat, the release of this information causes the plants to alter, or the industries to alter their emissions, and we'll be developing results on that as time goes by. So this kind of hand-in-hand collaboration between universities and governments, Epic India is currently engaged in that in many different states. We're very excited about the prospects of doing that in Odisha, and we've doing it with both national government and state governments and several corporate partners, and we have found that there's been support for this kind of work from foundations as well. So let me just close where I began with the picture of the Global Energy Challenge. Defining solutions to this Global Energy Challenge that take account of both the need for more energy and the environmental and climate consequences of energy choices, I think is really one of the greatest challenges that humanity faces in the coming decades. And I think there are really tremendous opportunities for making progress on that. And I would be happy to take any questions that people have.